sure to show up and for that wonderful time of fellowship and sharing. Notice our Mother's Day service will be only an AM service. We'll be honoring our mothers and remembering our mothers, for those who have mothers in heaven. So I hope you'll be here for that. On the Sunday after that, we have two special music services. The morning service, by the way, in heaven, will be providing a wonderful time of music and worship. I trust you'll be here for that. We'll be receiving an offering for his ministry, so come prepared to do that. And then in the evening, at 5 o'clock on the 21st, we'll be hosting the Association of Music Festival. Choirs from all over our association will be gathered here to sing. So I know you want to be a part of that time together. Now, we had any birthdays this week? Somebody? We're born to somebody.
Pam Massey had one.
All right. Anybody else?
Oh,
thanking you for another wonderful day. We ask that you be with those that can't be here. Be with Brother Ed as he brings your words to us today. At this time, we'd like you to bless our offerings as we return part of what you've given us back to our church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. close the book up, but you know the chorus by heart. And we'll get, let Glenn give us the key, and we're going to sing it out of the cup one time, just to hear it, because I'm so good at this.
Oh,
has a great message and needs to hear the Lord use it. Faith is the victory, number 413. Let's do all three verses in the choir. Can't come down on the left.
Beautiful custom that God commanded the Israelites to follow. and solve all of the welfare problems of their culture. We have an oppressive welfare program. We give so much away that we have incurred a $19 trillion debt in America, and we still can't solve the problems of poverty. You just can't give it out like that. You have to allow some way for people to maintain the dignity of work. And the way the Jews did it, they allowed people who were poor to glean at harvest time. That is, you know, they cut the stalks with the scythe, and they went through and gathered up the stalks, and then later they would beat them out and preserve the grain. This is barley, one of their primary crops. It was a winter crop. The wheat would be a spring crop. They followed one after the other. And so a person could go and pick up what the gleaners or what the harvesters left behind. And they were permitted to do that. So they were able to work, maintain some dignity, and yet still be provided for. So she departed and went and gleaned in the field after the reapers. And she happened to come to the portion of the field belonging to Boaz, who was of the family of Elimelech. And behold, Boaz came from Bethlehem and said to the reapers, "May the Lord be with you." And they said to him, "May the Lord bless you." And Boaz said to his servants, who was in charge of the reapers, "Whose young woman is this?" The servant in charge of the reapers replied, "She is the young Moabite woman who returned with Naomi from the land of Moab. And she said, 'Please let me glean and gather after the reapers among the sheaves.' Thus she came and has remained from the morning until now." She's been sitting in the house in a little temporary shelter for a little while. Then Boaz said to Ruth, "Listen carefully, my daughter. Do not go to glean in another field. Furthermore, do not go on from this one, but stay here with my maids. Let your eyes be on the field which they reap, and go after them. Indeed, I have commanded the servants not to touch you. When you are thirsty, go to the water jars and drink from what the servants draw." And she fell on her face, bowing to the ground, and said to him, "Why have I found favor in your sight that you should take notice of me, since I am a foreigner?" Boaz replied to her, "All that you have done for your mother-in-law after the death of your husband has been fully reported to me. And how you left your father and your mother and the land of your birth and came to a people that you did not previously know. May the Lord reward your work and your wages. Be full from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to seek refuge." Then she said, "I have found favor in your sight, my Lord. For you have comforted me, and indeed have spoken kindly to your maidservant, though I am not like one of your maidservants." At mealtime, Boaz said to her, "Come here that you may eat of the bread. Dip your piece of bread in the vinegar." So she sat beside the reapers, and he served her roasted grain. She ate and was satisfied and had some left. When she arose to glean, Boaz commanded his servant, saying, "Let her glean even among the sheaves, and do not insult her. Also, you shall purposely pull out for her some grain from the bundles and leave it, she may glean, and do not rebuke her." So she gleaned in the field until evening, and she beat out what she had gleaned, and it was about a half a farthing, about a half a bushel. She took it up, went into the city, and her mother-in-law saw what she had gleaned. She also took it out and gave it to Naomi what she had left after she was satisfied. Her mother-in-law then said to her, "Where did you glean today, and where did you work? May he who took notice of you be blessed." So she told her mother-in-law with whom she had worked and said, "Then name of the man with whom I work today is Boaz. Naomi said to her daughter-in-law, may he be blessed of the Lord, who has not withdrawn his kindness to the living and to the dead. Again, Naomi said to her, the man is our relative. He is one of our closest relatives. Then Ruth the Moabite said, furthermore, he said to me, you should stay close to my servants till they have finished all my harvest. Naomi said to Ruth, her daughter-in-law, it is good, my daughter, that you go out with his maids so that others do not fall upon you in another field. So she stayed close by the maids of Boaz in order to glean until the end of the barley harvest and the wheat harvest, and she lived with her mother-in-law. Boy, this story is getting better and better. Great story. How a faithful child was rewarded. Ruth is a special child, daughter-in-law. That's sometimes a difficult relationship, but in this case it was a beautiful one, and it is in many other cases. So as they came back home, Naomi being older, weaker, Ruth volunteered to be the one to go out into the field and glean. She found that there was great reward that came to her, and primarily because of her faithfulness to her mother-in-law Naomi. And next week we're going to talk about mamas a little bit. Today we need to talk about children. Children are a blessing from God. They're a gift from God. They are our heritage from God. Children are a blessing for a number of reasons. Many times it's just because they're children. We sang that great hymn, Because He Lives, How Sweet to Hold a Newborn Baby. There's just something special about children, especially babies, which you know my involvement in and support of the Save a Life Ministry, which is a ministry of the gospel to women with trouble or unwanted pregnancies. Sometimes there's a desire on the part of these ladies to have a child aborted, and we encourage them not to. That's a good ministry with that. What we have learned out of that ministry, and what many of us have learned from personal experience, is that no matter how a child gets here, when he or she finally gets here, all the other stuff doesn't matter. They're just a beautiful child. Now, we would all love for every child to be born to a mama and a daddy who loves them and cares for them, committed to them, who stay together for life and give that kind of stability. But you know, not all children have that, but all children are a blessing. But children need to learn to be a blessing as well. And I want to talk a little bit about it. Ruth's experience, the reward that she received from being a faithful child. She's an adult child, but she was a child nevertheless. The first reward is that she had a good name. You know, sometimes we look for the reward in terms of something else that might be given to us, but the Proverbs writer tells us that a good name is to be desired above riches, to have that reputation that comes out of character that is molded by life and comes out trusting God better for the experience. That is a wonderful, wonderful testimony. The good name, the good reputation, the good character. Ruth had that. She had that because she was faithful to Naomi. And the story of her faithfulness to Naomi came back home and probably came ahead of her. Boaz knew all the details of the story. He knew the heartache she had experienced, the loss of her husband. She knew that if there was that heartache from the loss of her father-in-law. She knew the heartache of being separated from the other daughter-in-law who also had that same grief. And yet, here she is, still faithful to Naomi. Naomi has become bitter so much so that she told her neighbors not to call her Naomi anymore. The name means pleasant. She said, call me Mara, for I'm bitter. God has dealt bitterly with me. She was bitter, but Ruth wasn't. Ruth just put her shoulder to the wheel, resolved to do whatever she could to help her mother-in-law. And as a faithful child, the great reward is the good name. Sometimes the reward for good behavior is just the fact that we have good behavior, isn't it? You know, we can't have a productive, safe society when people are not behaving well. So good behavior is a blessing to everybody, not only to our parents, but to everybody. But the good behavior sometimes is all reward. But you know, you always get more of what is rewarded. And so when a child has good behavior, there needs to be a reward sometimes, so they'll continue that good behavior. Teachers learn that. Parents learn that. Even employers learn that. When they have good employees, they want to reward those good employees, so they'll keep them, and so they'll get more of that good behavior. Ruth had the good reputation, but it was because she also had a good character. She was rewarded with a good name. He was also granted the promise of her new God. I don't know how faithful Naomi was in teaching about God in the land of Moab, but I have an idea she did talk a lot about God. And Elimelech, her husband, certainly was a godly man. And, he indeed had a name to mean God reigns, so he accepted God as the Lord of his life. So I'm sure they talked about God's covenant with Israel, especially as it's expressed in the commandments. And you know that beautiful commandment about honor your father and your mother, that it that days in the land that he gives you would be prolonged. To the Israelites, the promise was one of a long life in the land that God gives. The New Testament writer Paul in the book of Ephesians added something to that promise when he said it's the first commandment of the promise. And of course, he was an Old Testament scholar, so I'm assuming that Paul is giving us the full meaning of that Old Testament scripture. He says it's the first commandment with promise, true provision, that it may go well with you and that you may live long. A long, well-lived life is the blessing and the promise that God grants to faithful children. And Ruth was learning something about this promise. She had an adopted land, an adopted family, an adopted people. But she was learning that there is great reward in claiming the promises of God. Now, I know sometimes it looks like God's not living up to his promise, but our circumstances don't turn around. When there's an early death, when there's a serious injury, when there's sickness, when there are disappointments in life, relationships fall apart, all those bad things happen. So, God, where are you? Well, he's here all the time. We need to remember that God is the one who takes the long look. And we need to remember even from this story that Ruth and Naomi had a lot of heartache to go through before they got to the good stuff. So in the end, you can count on the promises of God that were granted to Ruth. But I think the most important lesson we see in this scripture is that Ruth learned that the reward of a faithful child is that she was given grace from God and his people. She was given grace from God and his people. She had a positive outlook. She said to Naomi, let me go reap so that maybe wherever I go, someone will find favor with me. They'll like my work ethic. They'll look kindly upon me. So she had the right attitude. But verse 3 gives us the first hint of God's grace. She happened to come to the portion of the field belonging to Boaz. She happened. That's almost coincidental. It was coincidental. But we all know that God's grace is not coincidental. God's grace is very deliberate. It was God's grace who guided her to the right field. She happened. was God's grace. God's grace was shown to her in the favor that was given by Boaz's servants and by Boaz himself. I think it's interesting that the servant knew her story as well as Boaz knowing her story. So all of that contributed to their finding favor, giving grace to her. The grace was not only that she could glean in the field, but that there would be an extra portion left behind for her to glean. That there would be a sharing of a lunch, of a meal with the master of the field. That's extra grace, and that's grace that we can look forward to as well. But one day we'll be seated at the table of our Master Jesus, and we'll feast with him forever. She also was given water from the water that was drawn for the servants. And I think that is highly symbolic. Boaz made reference to the fact that all the grace that he gave to her was a result of God's grace. And in verse 12, he said, "May the Lord reward your work, and your wages be full from the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to seek refuge." He said, "Look, I'm not doing this just because I'm a good person. I'm doing this because God has been good to me. God is the God of Israel, and we are under his wing." Under his wing means that he provides for us. He protects us. Protection that came from God was extended from Boaz when he said, "Don't glean in another field, because if you go to another field, somebody might rob you of your gleanings at the end of the day, or somebody might molest you, might hurt you, might harm you, may even take your life to take from you what you have earned. So you stay here." And she enjoyed the protection of Boaz and his servants. She enjoyed the provision that was made by him, but really which came from the Lord. Not only did she get those, what I call negative blessings, the protection, the care, there was also those positive ones, the extra provision, the water that was provided, and most of all, the kindness that Boaz demanded his servants give to her. She was a foreigner. She was a Moabite woman, one of the bitterest enemies to Israel. It was just a terrible relationship throughout her history, still is. And so she said, "I'm a foreigner, and yet you've given me grace." Later on, she said, "You've been good to me, even though I don't look like you're other women here." Not sure what that means, if her skin color was different. And certainly, her physical features, she looked different. She was a recognizable foreigner. But she found the grace of God that allowed her to be brought into the family. Of course, later on we're going to find out she became a part of the royal family because her baby was the grandfather of David and one in the long line of the lineage of our Lord Jesus. Ruth, the foreigner, came just as she was and found the grace. That same grace is available to you if you'll trust it. See, that's what faithfulness is trust. But just as you are, trust God, and He will reward you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this beautiful story. How your kindness and grace is poured out on Ruth, not only through your Spirit that guided her, but through the people that she adopted. I pray, Lord, that you will remind every one of us here that you have adopted us into your family and given us an inheritance that can never be revoked. So praise you for that. Lord, I pray also that you will help us to be like Boaz and the people in Bethlehem who received Naomi and Ruth back into their fold. Lord, help us to be receptive to those who need to know Jesus as Savior and Lord. Let us be channels of grace and blessing to those who are lost. Father, I pray that this very day, if there is one in this room who is in need of a special blessing from your grace, that you will help them to open their hearts and to release whatever is holding them back to receive your grace this day. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Our hymn of invitation today is number 311. Number 311, if you have a need to respond to the Lord in any way, I invite you to come and stand together. Examine that time of our